Welcome back. So far we have been studying the general Monte Carlo methods. From now on, we'll be studying the Monte Carlo methods for the neutron transport and reactor physics simulations. And in this mini lesson, we will learn about how to sample the distance between two neutron collisions. When we want to simulate a neutron history, then one of the basic random variables that we need to sample during the Monte Carlo simulation is the distance between collisions. So let's assume that the neutron is born in a fission reaction at some point, and then it scatters. It may scatter until it is captured at another place, or it may leak out of the system. We need to be able to sample the distances between the scattering collisions. These distances are random variables. These are continuous random variables, and I have been using these as for examples in my previous slides, so you already know that the probability density function for the distance between two collisions is given as the product of the total macroscopic cross-section and the exponential function, the exponent minus sigma t s, where s is the distance between two subsequent collisions. Now we know that the total macroscopic cross-section is a function dependent on two variables. One of the variables is the position. In principle, the total macroscopic cross-section may be changing along the flight of the neutron. So for now, let's just assume that the total macroscopic cross-section does not change during the flight of the neutron till the next collision. Later we are going to remove this assumption, and we will see how to sample the distance when the total macroscopic cross-section does change. And the other variable on which the total macroscopic cross-section is dependent is the energy of the neutron. So typically the neutron that comes from the fission neutrons, they have the energy around 2 MeV, so they are very fast. And the total macroscopic cross-section is relatively small for fast neutrons. As the neutron loses the energy via the successive collisions, the energy goes down and the total macroscopic cross-section increases. However, in between of the collisions, the neutron energy is constant. Therefore, we can also assume that the total macroscopic cross-section does not change because of the change of the neutron energy during the flight of the neutron till the next collision. So our task is to sample the distance s in such a way that the distribution of our samples will have the probability density function fs, which is the exponential function. We are going to do this by transforming random numbers that are coming from the random number generators, and they have uniform distribution over the interval 0, 1. So we are going to transform these random numbers into the random numbers given by our FS probability density function. Now we have learned about two methods that can do this transformation. One of them is the inverse transform method, and the other one is the acceptance rejection method. Now we know that we can use the inverse transform method when we can obtain the cumulative distribution function for our random variable that we want to sample in some convenient form. And that is actually our case. So our cumulative distribution function is the integral from, in this case, 0 to s of the probability density function sigma t, and then the exponential function. Now the value of s here is constant, so I'm going to mark the s with the prime sign so that you are not confused. Now we have actually calculated this integral before, because we have taken this function when we were learning about the cumulative distribution functions, so we know the result is 1 minus the exponential function with the exponent minus sigma t s. So this cumulative distribution function looks like this. So then during the simulation, random numbers are selected uniformly from the interval 0, 1, so for instance here, 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 and the inverse transform method will find the corresponding distances using this cumulative distribution function. So one value will be selected here, another here, and finally here. So to find these distances, we need to solve a simple equation. U, that is the random number between the interval 0 and 1, must be equal to 1 minus e to the power of minus sigma t s. So here, the number of u we generate, so that is a known parameter, and the total macroscopic cross-section we know, that is given by the material and the energy of the neutron, and s is the unknown, so we need to solve this equation for s. So I'm going to move the exponential function to the left-hand side, and the rest to the right-hand side. Now I will apply the logarithm on both sides of the equation. So on the left hand side, I will only have the exponent as a result, and on the right hand side, the logarithm 1 minus u. So finally I can write that the distance equals minus 1 over sigma t times the logarithm 1 minus u. Now u is the random number that we generate from the interval 0 and 1. However, the term 1 minus u is also a random number from the interval 0 and 1. And therefore, we can substitute the 1 minus u with simply u. So we typically do this operation here because it will save us some computing cost. We don't have to subtract the random number from 1 anymore, we can use it directly. And it will not affect the distribution of the distances between collisions. This distribution will still be given by the correct probability density function. So here we have just a summary of what I have derived on the previous slide. Now, the title of this mini lesson is the transition kernel, and I didn't explain yet what it is. Well, it is just a fancy name for the probability density function that gives the distances between two collisions. So our well-known function, the product of the total macroscopic cross-sections and the exponential function, that is the transition kernel. So when we are sampling the distances between two collisions, we are saying that we are sampling the transition kernel. The rest of this slide is just a summary of the derivations I have made on the previous slide. I want to remind you that the derivations we have made contain the assumption that the total macroscopic cross-section is constant along the flight in between the two collisions, so the material properties do not change. So it's in homogeneous material. The result we obtained is that the distance between two collisions is sampled by a very simple equation, minus 1 over sigma t multiplied by the logarithm of the random number between 0 and 1. Now, materials of real systems are not homogeneous over the whole system, so that is a complication to us. Let's have a look at this demonstration. We have a system which is composed by several layers here, and there are interfaces in between the layers. So one material has the total macroscopic cross-section sigma t1, then we have another material with another total macroscopic cross-section sigma t2, and then we have two other materials. So let's assume that we have a neutron with some direction and energy starting here, and we want to sample the distance to the next collision. So we don't know where the collision may occur. It may be here, but it also may be here. That depends on the energy of the neutron, and it depends on the total macroscopic cross-sections. If they are very small, then the distance may be very large, and the neutron may fly through all these materials. So when the neutron starts at this point, the collision probabilities are given by the total macroscopic cross-section in the first material. So we can calculate the distance to the next collision according to the formula that we have obtained. We can calculate S equal to minus 1 over sigma t1 times the logarithm of our random number u, 1. Now, it may happen that the distance that we calculated is actually somewhere here. So it's smaller than the distance to this interface. So when this case happens, we can simply move the neutron here, and we can simulate a collision at this point, and we are done. However, it can happen that the distance that we obtained is actually larger than the distance to this interface. The distance may be somewhere here. Now, clearly, we cannot place the collision to this point, because once the neutron passed through this interface, the total macroscopic cross-section has changed. While when we calculated this formula, we assumed that the total macroscopic cross-section is constant along the flight towards the new collision. So this formula is no longer possible to use for us. We cannot accept this distance as the site for the new collision. So when the sample distance is larger than the distance to the interface between the materials, then we have a problem. Now, fortunately, we can solve this problem by doing a simple trick. And the trick is in moving the neutron from the original point to the point of the interface. So we move it right here in between the two materials, and we do a simple assumption here. The assumption is that the neutron has no memory. And that is correct. Neutrons don't remember. They don't remember how long they've been flying, what has been the distance they've been flying since the last collision. They don't remember. They are always in the same state, so long as they have not collided yet. So we simply move the neutron here, and we use this formula again, but this time with a new total macroscopic cross-section. So we are going to generate a new distance. So let me write it. The distance again is minus 1 over sigma t 2 logarithm, but now I'm going to use a new random number u 2. And again, I have to compare the new distance to the distance to the next interface, which is right here. So if our new distance is smaller than the distance to this interface, then I simply move the neutron by the distance I calculated, and I simulate the collision there. If the distance by chance is greater than the distance to the next interface, then I have to repeat the procedure once again. So this procedure is repeated until the site for the new collision is eventually sampled. So as you have noticed, this procedure requires that we calculate the distance to the next interface. Okay? We need to calculate this distance and compare it to the sampled value of the distance between collisions. Now the calculations of the distance to the next interface is relatively simple when the interface is just a plane, but we have more complicated surfaces, interfaces between two materials. They may be curved, and when you have many of these interfaces which are close to each other, this procedure becomes computationally very expensive. So a considerable amount of computing cost in the Monte Carlo simulation of the neutron transport goes for the calculation of the distance to the next interface. So here is just a brief summary of the algorithm for sampling the distance between two collisions in inhomogeneous material. So we follow this algorithm. We generate a random number between 0 and 1 and we transform it into a distance S using the actual total macroscopic cross-section of the material in which the neutron is positioned, and then we compare this distance to the distance to the next interface between the current material and the material which is behind the interface. If S is smaller than the distance to the interface, then we are done. We can simulate the collisions at that distance. If by chance the S is larger than the distance to the next interface, then we simply move the neutron to the next interface and we repeat the algorithm. So we generate a new random number and we recalculate the value of S and we follow the procedure so many times until the S number is eventually smaller than the distance to the next interface. At that point we are finished. And that is all. Have a nice day.